Ma'am, can you hear me? Ma'am, can you hear me?
Yeah, actually, you have a tight schedule today. No.
Yes, ma'am, can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you. Can you hear me? Okay. I have a very bad cold. Okay, so today we'll finish the session quickly. Like, this will be the last part of this chapter. Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Last class. Last class we saw about enzymes, no?
Ma'am, last class we saw about enzymes, proteins.
Huh. Okay. So this time we'll see about like how the enzyme action happens. Okay. And we will see how what are the classifications for general classification for an enzyme. Okay. So that is the last part of the chapter. And from this area, again, a lot of questions are generally asked. Okay. So we need to like remember, there's nothing like very difficult concept and all to understand. You need to learn the definition and examples which are given in your textbook.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So it's actually a very easy portion. So we'll learn that today, okay? Let me just share the screen. Oh, I don't think I can share the screen. I'm not the host yet, no?
Oh, yeah. Oh, ma'am, you are the host.
Oh, yes, I am a host. When did she make me the host? I didn't even notice. Okay, anyway. Screen. Start now. Okay. Can you see?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, now see. So first we'll start with what are the factors that will affect the activity of your functioning of the enzymes. Okay. Hello.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Now here again there will be some graphs from which they'll generally ask the questions. So you need to know the graph well, okay? So any temperature which range in which the enzymes will work properly, like how it is supposed to work, is called as optimum.
Oh, okay, ma'am.
So if pH, like there is a particular pH, not very high pH or not very low pH where it works. And that pH is called as optimum pH.
Optimum pH.
Same way in temperature, we already saw. If it's high temperature, it will get denatured. If it is low temperature, it will get inactive.
Inactive.
So there is an optimum range of temperature. Now I can't say a generalized optimum temperature because it will vary from one enzyme to another enzyme.
Mm.
Okay, so the narrow range at which they work properly is called as optimum temperature.
Mm.
Okay, that's the definition you need. So we can also say that in that optimum temperature range, the enzymes will work its best. That means its activity will be, or rate of the reaction will be maximum.
Mm.
Okay, that's the concept for temperature. So we already discussed this. That's the reason I'm not focusing on it again. So I hope you know by now why, when the temperature increases, it gets inactive.
Temperature increase, denaturation of this thing.
When I say denaturation, what does it mean?
The bond is breaking.
And what will happen?
The enzyme will split into like small fragments.
Enzyme will not split. You should say that it becomes into its primary structure.
Huh. That's like smaller fragments.
Okay. Now, hello. 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 Mamata, can you hear me? Akshay?
Yes, ma'am.
I just need a second. I'll be back, okay?
Yes, ma'am.
Hello.
Yes, ma'am. Yes.
So sorry about it. Sometimes when people start calling, they don't stop talking. Where am I? Yes. Okay. So now can you see the screen?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. I don't know if you remember last time I did mention about something called a substrate or enzyme concentration.
Ma'am, we did this, ma'am.
We didn't do this.
We did glutathione.
This is just recalled.
Oh.
When the pH changes, the proteins act like a Zwitter ion and manage.
Yeah, glutathione is like when both positive and negative charge is present.
Correct, yes. And you were the only one who told me this, and also how in low pH it will have NH3 plus, and how in
High pH it last CO minus.
yes, correct. So since you know the concept very well, let's not dig there more and more. Okay, now coming to substrate concentration and enzyme concentration. Okay, it's a very logical stuff. So like last class I told you that if there are like 10 enzymes and then 5 substrate, enzymes are more, correct? So if all the 5 substrates bind to the 10 enzymes, okay, there will be no more substrates for the enzymes to bind with, correct? So initially, when all the substrates will go and bind with the enzyme, the rate of the reaction will be very, very high. It will keep on increasing. But at one point, what will happen? There will be no more substrate to bind with enzyme. There will be no more reaction happening. The reaction will be saturated. So what will happen is you will get a sigmoid curve like this. Can you see this curve?
Oh, like those this thing in like the graph in organism population.
Correct. Yes, correct. Same concept. Wherever the sigmoid curves are coming, no, it's very similar concept. The rate
It
of the
will increase
reaction.
to a certain extent, after that decrease.
Correct, exactly. So here the graph that we are talking about is con substrate concentration and rate of the reaction. Okay, so as the substrate concentration increases,
Yes, ma'am.
okay, like if there are more and more enzymes and more substrates, they'll keep binding again and again, and the rate of the reaction will increase at a proportion. After one point of time, there will be no more substrate to bind with or no more enzymes to bind with. Then what will happen to the rate of the reaction? It will become constant.
Constant.
Okay, so this graph is important. This concept is important. So here, when I say rate of the reaction, I can talk in terms of velocity. Okay, and when the velocity is half of the peak velocity, the peak velocity is given as V max. That is the maximum rate of the reaction is given as what? V max. Okay, half of V max, when the rate of the reaction is half of it, and the substrate concentration corresponding to it is called as Km. Okay,
Ma'am, can you repeat one more time?
maximum velocity is V max. Okay, and when the rate of the reaction is half, that is velocity of the reaction is half of the maximum velocity, whatever Km it is, like whatever substrate concentration is called as a Km. Okay, so when velocity of the reaction is half the way through of the maximum velocity, how much concentration of the substrate is there? That is indicated by a constant called as Km. Km
AM.
stands for Mendeley's constant.
Mendeley's constant.
Yeah, so how this will change because of certain factors that we will see later on. Okay, that is the reason why I'm repeating this again and again, because this question was asked. Okay, yes, so the same concept with enzyme concentration also. After one point of time, there is no more enzymes to bind. What will happen?
The reaction enzyme activity will decrease.
It will decrease, correct. Okay, so where is it? Yes. Now this brings us the concept of inhibitors.
Ma'am,
So
what concept of
inhibitors.
inhibitors?
Huh. Last class I told you that an enzyme will have a site at which the substrate will bind, that is called as what site? What site
Some
it was?
technical name was given.
Not big name and all, it's chappa name only. What is it?
inhibitors. No, inhibitors, they shut off the chem, they stop the reaction.
Stop reading from the PPT. It's not related to this at all.
Some name you had told, ma'am, some complicated name only.
Active site is very
Active,
complicated name, huh?
ma'am, no, I got it now. You don't tell me the answer, I got it. Active site.
So answer solar paper and won't tell me answer. Ayyo, okay.
Oh, I didn't
So
realize you told.
yeah. So sometimes what happens is that you like our body needs to stop like the reaction from happening. Okay,
How
because
other
at the
inhibitors are used?
yeah, like say for example, like methanol. Methanol will form formaldehyde and it is a poison for our body. Okay, now there is an enzyme that is involved in that reaction. Alcohol, some dehydrogenase. Okay. Now I don't want that reaction to happen. So what they will do is there's a drug for it, which consists of ethanol.
Oh yeah, ma'am, I know this injection of ethanol into the body to prevent methanol from being produced. I read this in 12th somewhere.
Exactly. So what will happen is that ethanol, how it will work is that it will go and bind with the enzyme that where the methanol is supposed to bind. And it will prevent the reaction from happening. Okay, so here, what is the function of the ethanol here? It is making sure that the methanol, which is the original substrate, is not binding with the enzyme to form the product.
Yeah,
So it
so
is
it
acting
prevents
as
the
an,
formation of formaldehyde.
yes, so it is acting as an inhibitor. Okay, so inhibitors are basically chemicals which will make sure that it will stop the function of the
Methanol, that
not
enzyme,
methanol.
dehydrogenation enzyme.
No. That's just an example. In
Oh,
general,
generally it will stop the function of an enzyme.
correct. It dissolves the function of an enzyme. Okay. Now it can do it in different ways. So what it will do is, one first way is that enzyme and the substrate, both of them will have the same structure. Okay. And we know that the substrate generally binds with the enzyme. It's specific to that one particular enzyme, yes or not?
Yes, ma'am.
So like I told you, lock and key mechanism last time, remember?
Yeah, so one enzyme will work only for one particular this substrate.
Correct. So now we also have a concept of duplicate keys, yes?
Oh yeah.
Huh. So there are certain inhibitors which are like duplicate keys. They are not the original one, but they look like the original key and they do the function of the original key. So what will happen is when there is an enzyme and there is an I mean enzyme, then there is a substrate and there is a inhibitor. Okay, and the inhibitor and the substrate shape are the same. The inhibitor will go and bind with the enzyme. So now will the reaction happen or not?
The inhibitor will go bind with the enzyme means it won't happen.
Correct. So such kind of inhibitors who's competing with the substrate to bind at the active site is called as competitive inhibitor. Got the concept here?
Yes, ma'am.
So if instead of enzyme substrate complex, I will get an enzyme inhibitor complex. Okay, so what are competitive inhibitors?
They compete with the substrate for like duplicate keys.
To bind at which site?
Active site.
Active site. That is another point you need to remember. The reason is because there are some inhibitors which will not bind at the active site and all. It will go and bind at some other site in the enzyme and stop the reaction.
Non-competitive. Non-competitive.
Non-competitive. Okay. And the site, some other site other than the active site where it binds is called as allosteric site.
Allosteric site.
Yes. Okay. Note it down somewhere. I don't think it is there in the PPT.
One second. Where is it? Yes, ma'am. Allosteric.
Site is the site where inhibitor binds to the enzyme other than the active site.
Is where? Ma'am, is where?
The inhibitor binds to the enzyme
The enzyme other than the
active site.
yes, ma'am.
So here what it will do, no, it will change the shape of the lock itself. So substrate can't bind anymore. So here the inhibitor is not competing, but it is making sure the reaction is not happening. So that kind of inhibitors are called as non-competitive inhibitors. And the function is called, I mean, or the process is called as non-competitive inhibition. Got the difference?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So so this graph, actually, this is a graph which we saw earlier, rate of reaction and substrate concentration. Remember?
Yes, ma'am.
So your maximum rate of the reaction, okay, is like shown in green without the inhibitors. So with the inhibitors or with the competitive inhibitors, what will happen? The rate of the reaction will decrease. Okay, so that's why the graph will shift. Can you see the red line?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, and when the graph shifts, your Km also will shift.
Dissociation constant. I mean, oh no, no, sorry. KM.
The mental is constant.
Mental is constant. Yeah.
What is the definition for that?
Too much chemistry added, so I was like, KM means, oh yeah, dissociation constant.
What is the definition for it?
Ma'am, it is at that V half, that constant that is there in the X axis.
Now my question is, here, will the Km increase or decrease?
It will decrease.
Are you sure?
Yeah.
Okay, let's see that then. Okay, I'll come back to that question.
Is it decrease? Was I right or wrong?
No, I'll come back to that question. First, let me finish this and I'll come back to that. Okay, today we'll discuss some questions related to the session. No, so you'll understand how it is decreasing or increasing. Okay? Hey, what is it? Because this I need another graph to tell you whether it is increasing or decreasing. Why do you say it's increasing?
I just told.
Hey. Okay. What is the KM stands for?
Ma'am, Mendel is constant.
When there is an inhibitor, will the KM increase or decrease?
Decrease.
Why?
I don't know. I just feel it decreases. Does it increase?
Like KM stands for the substrate concentration. No. So logically speaking, when there is an inhibitor, the substrate concentration will be more. No, because the inhibitor is going to bind to the enzyme.
So, oh yeah.
Shouldn't KM increase?
KM will increase.
Okay. So how that, I'll show you with the graph, after the session is over. Okay.
Yes,
that graph is not there. The KM graph is not here. Anyway, yes. So coming to this concept of methanol. So methanol poisoning is an example for competitive inhibitors. Wherein ethanol is your competitive inhibitor. Okay, this is how your drugs work. Like the medicines you eat, right? How do they actually achieve their what they are meant for? So most of them, what they do is they make sure they go bind with the enzymes. So either as a competitive inhibitor or non-competitive inhibitor. Is this clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So another example for this is that succinate. Okay. So succinate conversion. Where did we see this conversion succinate? We saw this reaction somewhere in one of the chapters we learned.
Respiration.
Correct. Very good. Which cycle was that?
It was not Krebs cycle. It was citric acid cycle.
That's Krebs cycle only, no? So there we saw the conversion of succinate to malate, no?
Malate.
So that the enzyme that helps if I don't want that reaction to happen, it will not happen in the presence of malonate. Because if you see the structure of malonate and succinate is similar. So what will happen? Instead of the succinate going and binding, the malonate will go and bind and there will be no product formed. So in the case of the methanol, who is this competitive inhibitor?
Ethanol.
And in the case of succinate?
Malate.
these two examples, remember, okay? Now, like as I said, non-competitive inhibition is where the enzyme binds to a site other than the active site. And what active is a site called?
The site is called, wait, now. One second. The site is called allosteric site.
Allosteric site. Okay, very good. Okay, so here what will happen is that the shape of the enzyme will change, so the substrate can no longer bind.
It no longer fit. Yeah.
Yeah. So here if you see the rate of the reaction, okay, is going to be lower than that of your competitive inhibition. Okay, so the graph would be this. This is what I was talking about. Okay, so in the case of your competitive inhibitor, okay, whenever your competitive inhibitor is there, the rate of the reaction, that Vmax, is going to remain the same. What is going to change is your Km. Okay, and in the case of non-competitive inhibitors, the Km is going to remain the same. What is going to change is the...
So in competitive, Vmax is different... Vmax is different, Km is same, but in non-competitive, Km is different, Vmax.
You just said the opposite. In competitive inhibitors, who is binding to the enzyme?
In competitive, this thing only, the inhibitor.
So substrate concentration will?
Increase.
Increase, yes. So therefore, Km also will?
Increase.
Increase. So Km is change, okay. But the maximum velocity of the reaction will remain the same.
Same.
Okay, now when you come to non-competitive inhibitors, who's binding?
No one.
Who's binding?
Oh, substrate.
Inhibitors are binding, and there is no place for the substrate to bind. In non-competitive inhibitors, anyway, the substrate will bind to the active site. But what is the point here? It will change its shape, because of the inhibitor. So what is going to happen is the substrate concentration will remain the same, but the rate of the reaction will change.
Will change. Come on, one second.
Yeah.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so this is where the question is generally asked. Oh, please remember it.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, what changes where? Now, example for your non-competitive inhibition is heavy metal poisoning.
Heavy metal?
Poisoning. Like, for example, your mercury. Okay, so what happens is that, whenever mercury binds, okay, like the water we drink and all, right? So they say, no, like there'll be like this metal. Have you heard of this lead and all those things? More than a desired level, it is not good for our health. So how can we cure that? Okay, if there is a heavy metal poisoning because of certain metals that we have in our daily food or our drinks. Okay, so for that, we can have mercury as a medicine. Okay, mercury containing medicines. Why? Because mercury will act as a non-competitive inhibitor. It will go and bind with the allosteric site and change the shape of the your enzyme. Okay. So I told you earlier, like drugs are meant to work like this, right? So whenever there is a heavy metal poisoning, or the drug that we give will contain what?
From the drug that we have will contain inhibitors.
What inhibitor? If it's heavy metal poisoning.
If it's heavy metal poisoning, uncompetitive, mercury.
Mercury. Okay. Now, Now we come to another concept called uncompetitive. Okay, so here, when that enzyme and substrate complex is formed,
no, mercury is uncompetitive, or mercury is the other one, non-competitive?
No, it's non-competitive. Okay, so uncompetitive is like, it will, instead of binding to just an enzyme, it will bind to an enzyme substrate complex and stop the reaction in the middle.
Oh,
that's uncompetitive. So what are the three types of inhibitors we saw?
Competitive, non-competitive, uncompetitive.
Competitive means?
Competitive means it binds to the, it acts as like, it only like acts as the key and it binds at the active site.
Okay. And it will stop the enzyme from bind, I mean, a substrate from binding with the enzyme.
Enzyme.
In the case of non-competitive?
In case of non-competitive, it binds at a site called allosterin site.
Which is not an active site.
Active site. And then that key will be, the lock will be modified, so the key won't fit.
Okay. And what about uncompetitive?
It binds in between, like it binds directly to the substrate.
No, it doesn't bind to the substrate. It will bind when the enzyme and substrate are together.
It will bind when enzyme and substrate are together. That is in between.
Yeah. Yeah, like not in between, it's some other site it will bind. So it is basically like breaking two lovers.
Oh, Papa.
Okay, yeah, I know. Now we will come to the last part of this chapter, which is basically classification of enzymes. So these terms and all you would have already heard, like say for example, dehydrogenases, hydrolases. Have you heard these terms before?
Yes, ma'am.
These are common names that are given to a class of enzymes. Like for example, we learnt in digestion, like carbohydrases. All the enzymes which are involved in the digestion of carbohydrate is called as carbohydrases.
All the enzymes in digestion of carbohydrate is carbohydrases.
Yes. Then proteases, what should it be?
Proteases for protein.
Digestion of protein. So the term ases is given when the enzyme is, it's an enzyme. So by looking at it itself, you can say it is an enzyme or not. Because at the end of the enzyme name, there will be always ases.
Oh.
The suffix will be ases.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So we can basically, you can understand that what reaction it is going to do from the name of that itself. Okay, so different types of enzymes are the oxidoreductases, transferases, hydrolases, lysases, isomerases, ligases. So what these are, we'll see one by one. Okay, so your oxidoreductases is nothing but dehydrogenase. So what it is going to do?
What oxidative?
Oxidoreductases. That means it is going to do both oxidation and reduction reaction.
Oxidative dehydro. Oxidoreductases means oxidation and reduction.
Yes. So if I have like, say here in this example itself, you can see if I have like two products A and B, A will get oxidized. By the time it's formed as product, B will get reduced. Okay, so basically oxidoreductases are enzymes which perform the function of oxidation and reduction. That is redox reactions basically. Okay, so all those enzymes that perform that function come under the classification called as?
All enzymes.
All enzymes that perform the function of redox reaction come under the classification called as?
Oxidoreductases.
Also known as?
Dehydrogenases.
Okay. Transferases. Transferases means it is going to transfer a group from one of the substrates to the other. Those kind of enzymes are called as transferases.
Hydrolysis, breaking of water, breaking of bond by adding water.
Yeah. So by looking at the particular name itself, you can predict what reaction they are going to do. Yes or not? Okay. So transferases means they are going to transfer something. Hydrolases means they are going
water.
To yes, they're going to add water. Okay, and lyases means breaking. Okay, whenever there is a breaking of something happening, you will, which enzymes will be used? Lyases. So to a certain extent, you can say that the carbohydrates and all are a type of lyases only. Then isomerases. Isomerases is basically creating the isomer. We have seen isomerases like in a lot of places. For example, in your glycolysis reaction, glucose gets converted to fructose. Remember?
Yeah.
Glucose 1,6-phosphate gets converted to fructose 1,6-phosphate. Yes. So that is basically isomer, correct? So the enzyme involved in it is an isomerase.
Isomerase.
Okay. So if you want to create isomers, enzyme is isomerase. And ligases. Ligate means join. I hope you know the term. What is the difference between lysis and ligate?
Ligate is join.
Lysis is?
The enzyme.
No, lysis is breaking.
Oh, lysis. Okay. I thought lysis is the enzyme.
Lysis is breaking. The enzyme involved in it is called as lyases.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So, these are, what are the different classes of enzymes?
Competitive.
No. Classes of enzyme. That is inhibitors.
Oh, enzyme. Ma'am, tell one, I'll tell their meaning.
That what we learned towards the end, ligases is an...
Oh, like that.
Ligases,
dehydrogenases, transferases, lyases, isomerases, proteases, lipases.
Hey, that and all comes under the class, Ada.
Carbohydrates.
I am talking about the general classes.
Isomerases, lyases, oxidoreductases or dehydrogenases. That's all I think. Lyases, hydrolysis, transferases.
So basically these are the general classes. So whatever enzymes we have seen till now comes under these categories. Like for example, there was a dehydrogenase enzyme that was involved in that methanol reaction. So that will come under which category?
That will come under, I only don't know.
Oxidoreductases or dehydrogenases category.
Okay, ma'am.
Got the concept of this?
Yes.
There's nothing to like remember. Okay. Choose a incorrect pair.
Competitive inhibitor. Inhibitor sits in active site. Correct.
Mm.
Inhibitor attaches to free enzyme is uncompetitive. B is wrong. B and C are wrong. B is wrong.
Why?
Non-competitive inhibitor does not attach to free enzyme.
It does attach to free
enzyme. That is uncompetitive, no.
Hey, uncompetitive is the one
which will... C is wrong. C is wrong.
No, C is also correct.
How competitive inhibitor sits in active site? Correct. Non-competitive inhibition, methanol poisoning treatment is correct. Hello?
Are you sure non-methanol is non-competitive?
Ma'am, you already told me, ma'am, it is not uncompetitive. It is not. It comes before uncompetitive. See. Methanol is...
Ethanol is actually a competitive inhibitor for methanol.
Sorry. Mercury, that thing is uncompetitive. Non-competitive.
Non-competitive.
Correct.
So the answer is?
B.
So basically, when the enzyme substrate complex is there, if an inhibitor is going and binding, what type of an inhibitor it is?
What, ma'am?
When an enzyme substrate complex is there, and an inhibitor is going and binding, what sort of inhibition it is?
Uncompetitive.
Competitive means?
Directly to active site.
So that means what it is doing actually here?
It is competing.
In which of the following will there be a change in the shape of the enzyme?
Ma'am, I can't see that question.
I'm asking you.
In which of the following?
Like in which of the following inhibitions... That is either competitive
or non-competitive.
Okay. This concept is clear, no? Then yes. So that we come to the end of
biomolecule.
No, we still have one concept called metabolism to learn.
Oh, but that is like 3-4 pages, no?
Yeah, that's an easy concept. You already
Anabolism, catabolism. We already did this similar thing, no?
Yes, we did it. So we're just going to revise because it's there in the reaction. Okay. So whenever there, these are all basic things that you already studied in chemistry. Say, for example, when there is a formation of substances, energy is going to be consumed.
Yes,
And
ma'am.
when there is a breakage, energy is released. And this is the same concept because of which ATP
That's
liberates
what we did,
energy.
the same anabolic catabolic pathway.
Correct. You remember that, right?
Yeah, anabolism, energy used, catabolism, energy released.
So I always told you whenever there's something
Yeah, Krebs
formed.
cycle. See, it's there.
Okay, so this concept is fine, right? So these are the set of metabolic pathways that happens in our body, okay?
What?
This particular
I
thing.
can't see. It's just the random lines.
No, it's not a random lines. There are that many reactions in our body that happens, is why you don't need to learn it. It's just
If
to
you
make you
zoom in
understand.
1000% also, I'll tell you, Baiju should have written some random thing.
No, this is actually from an external source, so.
Oh, they actually wrote.
So, like, when can you say an organism is like in a living state?
When it has a non-equilibrium steady state.
What do you mean by that?
I mean that.
Okay, so basically there are different functions that defines, like, see, what is the difference between us and a non-living thing?
Us are non-living thing, or we are living, we are moving.
Movement is not. Okay, let me tell you something. The defining characteristics, say, for example, if you say we are growing, and that is a defining property of a living thing,
Growth,
not.
reproduction, respiration.
So again, reproduction is very like very perspective. Like reproduction, actually, what is gonna happen when I say reproducing, new substances are formed, correct or not? Now,
Yes,
in the
ma'am.
case of your non-living thing also, what will happen is, like, for example, in your sand dunes and all, okay, the sand is getting accumulated. So there is a growth and new substances are also being added. Okay, so reproduction is actually not a defining characteristic to say that whether it's a living or a non-living thing. The only characteristic that says, like, the most defining characteristic which says that an organism is living or not is metabolic reactions. So if you take a wood will not have any metabolic reactions, but a human being will have, or any living organism for that matter will have a metabolic
Metabolic
reaction
reaction.
happening. Okay, so the defining characteristic, this comes in the first chapter. Okay, so the defining characteristic or property to define that, okay, this is a living organism is metabolism. Is
Okay.
that clear?
Yes, ma'am.
And once there is no metabolism in us itself, we are considered to be dead.
Yeah.
Okay, so always there is this non-equilibrium that is there in our body. You know, say for example, if everything like is at its level and there is no need of any regulation in our body, then there will be no metabolic activities. If there is no metabolic activities, means that person is considered dead.
Oh, yeah, correct.
Okay, that is why they say that in meta, like, our body is always in a non-equilibrium state, and our body constantly tries to maintain something called as homeostasis. This is something you should have learned already. What is homeostasis?
Homeostasis is the it's like they can maintain regular body temperature.
Not just temperature alone, the
Constant body
entire.
conditions, metabolic rate, all of that. Like it's like a dormancy type.
Yeah, how it is able to maintain it because of the various metabolic reactions that are
Metabolic
happening.
reactions inside the body will get slowed down. Yeah.
Yes, so that is the significance of metabolism. So with that, we are done with this chapter called biomolecules.
Okay, ma'am.
Just give me a second, we'll just do a few questions.
Yes, ma'am. After that, I'll go eat lunch and then I'll again back to back class till 6.
Oh, nice. So I'll give you a break earlier.
But now I have school. My school is till 12. I leave at 11 o'clock.
How come you can leave early like that?
No, only 2 hours is practical. 1 hour is just class because they haven't completed math portion.
Oh,
School only is consensual, no? So if we tell we are leaving, they won't tell anything. If it was normal school, then they'd stop. If it's like because the corona, no, they won't tell anything.
Very nice. Nice, ra. Allah enjoy panara. College la kuda ipdi engala vittadilla.
Ma'am, you just walk out, ma'am. No need consent, nothing. You don't even need to inform. They are just happy you're coming to school to do something.
Seriously.
Yeah, how? Ma'am.
How?
No, corona. No, if it was normal means then nothing. No matter what you tell, they won't let us. Now corona. Corona time.
Pare.
Corona, go. Go, corona. I'm now new strain in India, it seems.
Yeah, it's already there across in Europe and other places. So they're all like sit at home, but no. Okay, activation energy, what is it?
Huh?
Activation energy.
It is the amount of energy required to activate the functioning of an enzyme.
Yeah, so will it be more with like for a reaction with enzyme or without enzyme?
It will be more for reaction with enzyme.
Why?
Sorry, wait, what?
What is activation energy again?
It is the amount of energy required to activate the functioning of an enzyme.
Functioning of the enzyme or functioning of the reaction?
Functioning of the reaction involving the enzyme.
No.
What?
It don't enzyme doesn't come and place itself there.
Yeah, it is a reaction for that reaction to start. You need some energy, no?
That is activation energy, irrespective of if there is enzyme or not.
If there is enzyme, means activation energy is will increase.
It will decrease.
Sorry, because enzyme speeds up, so not much energy is required.
Yeah, exactly. So activation energy will
decrease
with enzyme.
Enzyme.
And the product will be formed faster.
Ma'am, next class, which chapter?
Next. So we finished biomolecules. So now we can actually finish excretory and all those things. No?
Ma'am, we'll finish up one unit.
That's why. So we already have completed like cell unit.
We'll do, now cell is over. Now we'll do human physiology unit.
That's what. So we finished breathing. Now body fluids is there.
And digestion and breathing we finished.
Yeah, so next is body fluids we can do and we can finish it off. It's easy. It's a very small chapter, like compared.
And when can we keep class?
As in, I didn't hear.
Like, I'm going to school, no.
So like you, if this time is fine, yeah, this time is also okay for me.
Every day this time?
Every
day. We'll keep 1 hour.
Okay, no problem. That is also fine. Or anytime, like, you know, in the afternoon, if you're free also, it's fine.
Like 3 days. Next week, Tuesday, I don't have school anyways, ma'am. So Tuesday morning, we can have class.
Okay. Then do one thing. Just like, I don't think then we can have a fixed timing. No.
Yeah, ma'am. Like 3 days before or 2 days before, I'll inform you. You tell, okay.
Okay. Then no problem. Let me know.
Ma'am, tomorrow, our normal time, no? 11 or something we have.
Tomorrow, 11 o'clock. Okay, so tomorrow we will discuss like the previous year questions.
Okay, ma'am. And then we'll start next chapter.
Yeah. So let me just I'll read the question to you. Tell me the answer, okay?
Yes, ma'am.
The Km value of the enzyme
mm-hmm.
is the value of substrate concentration at which the reaction reaches to option 0, double of Vmax. Half of Vmax. Okay, correct. Good. Very good. Which of the following can influence enzyme activity? So this is easy. High temperature, pH, substrate concentration, all of these.
All of these.
Good. Okay. So like we learned about classes of enzymes, right?
Yeah.
How many classes did we learn?
6.
Correct. So basically, this 6 classes is actually recognized by International Union of Biochemistry.
IUBC.
Yeah. IUBC, yeah.
IUPAC is International Union of Pure and Applied Chemistry.
Okay, correct. So, yeah. So basically, this particular union is the one which gave this general 6 classes, okay? So there was a question on that. That's the reason why I asked you. Now, like lipase is there, no? So lipase, what does it do?
Lipase. Lipase is fats.
Lipid is fat.
What you just asked lipase.
Yeah, I just asked what is lipase.
It will convert this thing to fat. Fat to this thing.
Ah, so basically what does it do when it is doing like that? It breaks down the fats. Okay, so it basically hydrolyzes the fats. Okay, so lipases can be classified under what type of an enzyme?
Lipases, sir. Lipases comes under reducing.
No, lipases is basically breaking down of fats by hydrolysis of fats.
Oxidoreductases.
By hydrolysis of fats. So what should it be?
Hydrases.
Hydrolases.
Ma'am, too complicated. The names are.
The names are not at all complicated, right? It's easy only.
It's complicated, ma'am.
You're just thinking it's complicated, okay? Hydrolases. Hydrolysis. So easy. Just add an acid towards the end. It becomes an enzyme.
Yes, ma'am.
So lipases is an example for what type of an enzyme?
Hydrolysis. Hydrolysis.
Hydrolysis. Okay.
Done. Done. Done.
One second. I just have to tell you one more thing. Okay. So there's one more thing called as feedback inhibition. Feedback inhibition. Okay. So in the case of feedback inhibition, what will happen is that so we learned about allosteric site, right?
Yes, ma'am. Non-competitive.
Yes. So, like, what happens is that sometimes what will happen, this one will go and bind with the allosteric site, the inhibitor. Okay. So, when that happens, or not just the inhibitor, anything goes and binds with the site other than the active site. Okay. Even if a substrate goes and binds there, okay, what will happen is the enzyme will change its shape. And whatever products are formed after the enzyme changes its shape, okay, what will happen is that product will stop this process. Okay, stop the process, that reaction itself will be stopped by that product that is formed. And that is called as feedback inhibition. So basically what is going to happen is normally like the your non-competitive one, if it goes and binds at the allosteric site, okay, what is going to happen?
The other actual this thing will get blocked out because this thing will change, lock will change. Yes.
The enzyme will change its shape. Now, when the enzyme changes its shape, there might be some substrate which is capable of binding to it. And some sort of reaction would happen other than the original reaction that is supposed to happen. No.
That is feedback mechanism.
So what will happen is whatever product is formed at the end of that reaction will say that, okay, there is something wrong. This reaction has to be stopped. And that is a feedback mechanism. So that type of inhibition is called as feedback inhibition.
Okay, ma'am.
What is EPO enzyme?
EPO enzyme is a type of enzyme. Wait, ma'am. I know it, ma'am.
What is it?
It's something. It is. Wait. Ma'am, give one hint.
It's a part of the enzyme.
Is it the active? No, not active. Is it the inactive part of this thing?
Yes, and what part it is? What is it made up of?
I should revise once. It's made up of something. Wait, ma'am, I remember you had told me. Ma'am, active part of the enzyme is this, no? Proenzyme.
Proenzyme.
Active part of enzyme.
Okay, tell me what is this holoenzyme at least.
Ma'am, active part of enzyme is, wait ma'am, what you're asking? Proenzyme, no?
I never asked, there's no proenzyme at all. I never taught you anything like that.
Oh, proenzyme, something you would ask, no, just no.
Holoenzyme means the entire
enzyme. I know, it is apoenzyme and the factor.
Apoenzyme and your active site where active the site. Cofactor can bind.
So that is called apoenzyme. That is holoenzyme.
That is holoenzyme. And apoenzyme is a protein part. The non-protein part is?
Non-inactive part.
Non-protein part is called as cofactor.
Yes,
the cofactor can be organic or inorganic.
Inorganic, but apoenzyme has to be organic.
Because it's protein.
Yes.
Okay. And yes, give me an example for a cofactor which is inorganic.
Why, ma'am? Such hard questions.
Something we discussed, so this is nothing hard and all.
Give one hint, I'll tell.
No hint and all. Easy. There's nothing to give hint. What hint will I give you here?
Is it some... Ma'am, you only tell.
Zinc.
Oh, zinc. Well, all metal ions, you are told.
Correct. See? Didn't come next class. Your textbook. I will send the PPT only after that.
Yes, ma'am.
So tomorrow we can discuss the MTG book.
Done.
Yeah, take first half an hour or something. We can finish that and then we can see. Biomolecules is over. You were telling, no, ma'am, romba kashtam and all. It's easy chapter, no?
Still so much to remember. Now I'll go eat off lunch.
Yeah, sure. Go have your lunch then. Bye. See you tomorrow.